The following is an exclusive presentation of HDNet. Known as the Octagon's Ninth Side, Big John McCarthy is one of the most recognizable fixtures in mixed martial arts. After working for years with the LAPD, McCarthy made the jump in 1994 to the fledgling Ultimate Fighting Championship. Quickly becoming the face of the UFC, he refereed hundreds of fights until making a rocky exit 3 years ago from the promotion he helped create. What is his relationship now with the UFC? And what lies ahead for Big John McCarthy? He's our guest this week on Fighting Words with Mike Straka. From HDNet, this is Fighting Words with Mike Straka. This week's guest, Big John McCarthy. Now your host, Mike Straka.
Big John McCarthy, welcome to the program.
Thank you, Mike.
So you were a longtime UFC fixture and been there since the beginning as head referee. What are you doing these days?
I run my gym. I go all over the world refereeing and officiating. I teach all over the place. I just stay busy.
Right, let's talk about MMA. Since you were there from the start of it, how has the sport evolved over the years?
Oh, my God. I mean, the sport has evolved so much. You know, the sport started, it was really like an infomercial. That's what it was set up to be. You know, Horian Gracie had worked at trying to get people to, you know, take a look at, you know, jiu-jitsu and the form that, you know, his family was doing, and trying to get people to understand that it was an effective fighting form, but it just didn't have the flash of what, you know, other guys were doing, you know, the Don the Dragon Wilson out there, or all the guys that were doing the fancy kicks and stuff. Yeah, you know, and he couldn't get it out to a point where people would take him serious, and this was the vehicle. The UFC was the vehicle he used to actually get people to stop and take a look and say, whoa, maybe that grappling stuff is pretty good, and maybe it does work. And it was an infomercial at the start. Eventually that infomercial, you know, turned into a sport, and it's a true sport with incredible athletes that are in there now, and it's a completely different atmosphere.
Why do you think Horion picked Hoist to represent the family?
The best fighter in the family was Hickson. There's no doubt about it. I think, you know, after UFC 2, I think Hoist actually even came out in an interview in an article and, you know, said, well, my brother Hickson is 10 times better than I am. And everyone was like, well, who's this Hickson guy? But if you knew the family, you knew that Hickson was, he was the best guy they had. And Hickson was gonna be the guy who was gonna fight in the UFC at the beginning when it was actually called War of the Worlds. And Hickson was gonna be that representative until Hickson kinda opened up his own school, and he opened up a school in the West LA area, and Horian wasn't happy about it because he was the guy that was trying to put this together to get people to come to his school. Right. And if Hickson wasn't part of his school, Hickson wasn't gonna be part of his show. Hoist was at Horian's school, that's where he worked. And so I think they took Hickson out, put Hoist in, and that's how he got it. And, you know, and he represented the, you know, the art of jiu-jitsu, and he represented his family in a very honorable and incredible way.
You were part of Horian's school as well, teaching grappling at the LAPD, correct?
Well, I was part of Horian's school as a student. I did my own job as a tactics instructor and doing grappling and things with the LAPD, yeah, but that was all part of, you know, some of the things that I learned from Horian and his family.
Now, as legend has it, you were going to fight in UFC, and Horian talked you out of that. How did that come about?
You know, he didn't talk me out of it. That's just not true. I was dumb. Okay, I'm being honest. You know, they had the first UFC. I even had a friend call me, you know, because I was at it. I was there training with Horian. I had a friend call me, and he says, I saw this thing on TV. You would be perfect for it. He goes, there's this skinny guy that wanted, he said, you'll kill him. And I go, you talked about that Ultimate Fight. Yeah, that's it. And I said, no, that skinny guy's not, you just don't kill him. I'm with him. I'm learning from him and stuff. But I was naive enough to think, well, Hoist won the first one. Well, now they're going to bring somebody else in. I'd like to do it. So I filled out the whole thing, and I'd given it to the WOW Promotions, was the people that were on Horian's side doing stuff. And Horian called me and he says, well, you know, what is this? I said, well, I want to fight. He goes, well, you can't fight. Hoist is fighting. I said, I didn't even look at that. I figured, well, Hoist won, and you're going to do another one, and Hoist wouldn't be in it. And so that was, you know, how I started with thinking that, well, I'd like to do it. And from that point, he offered me to be the referee, and thank God that he did. It was the greatest thing he ever did for me.
You know, that goes back to martial arts and just respecting your instructors too, because even if you end up in a national karate tournament and one of your teachers is in the finals, typically you bow out.
Yeah, it's, things have changed some. The traditional martial arts has always been about honor and respect and giving respect to the masters and the people that started it. Because if they weren't there, then you wouldn't have anything now.
Right.
And, you know, absolutely. I would never, you know, ever challenge, you know, Horian or Hoist or anything. That wasn't what I was intending at that time. I was just too stupid to think, oh, yeah, they'd want him again. He's a star now.
Right.
You know, I just wasn't bright enough to think about that. But
well, these days it's a little different. The respect is still there, but you've got these super cams where Greg Jackson has a bunch of people, Cesar Gracie has a bunch of people, and teammates won't fight one another. What's your take on that?
MMA developed off of schools and camps, and we're together, and you know, this is our school, and we'll go and do something against, you know, this one. So when you're asking two guys that come from the same school, train with the same guys, you know, the blood and sweat and tears that goes into the hard work of getting to where they're at, then to have them have to fight against each other, well, one of them now has to leave because they're probably not going to be able to train at the same place. And if they can train at the same place, well, then if you're the Greg Jackson, you got to make a choice. Okay, do I sit in Rashad's corner in his dressing room and get him ready, or do I sit in Keith's corner in his dressing room and get him ready? You've got to split from one of them. So it's a hard situation. I understand how, you know, a Dana White is looking at it and saying, hey guys, I have a show, and if you're the two best fighters, I want to put you together. I don't blame him either.
Right. Talking about Dana and talking about the UFC, you retired from reffing for a short time to go do some commentating, to do other things. Do you regret that decision, or did it open up new doors for you?
Well, I can tell you, I made the decision based off of, I felt I was stuck. I was doing things with the UFC, and they were paying for some things for me, and I was making money, and then the commission would ask me to do something, and the UFC would not want me to do it, and it became a problem, and I couldn't make the two entities happy. And so I figured it's time for me to walk away because I can't do this. I love the UFC. I started with the UFC. I've been to court too many times for the UFC. I was there when everyone was saying how bad it is and, you know, trying to get people to understand. I love what the UFC is. I love what it represents as far as the sport. It is the number one show out there, and they do a phenomenal job. And it's not, you know, I hear people say, oh, John doesn't like the UFC. That's ridiculous. You know, I have not missed one UFC ever. You know, what does that say? You know, do I hate it? Come on. After doing the Roger Huerta Clay Guida fight, woke up the next day, and I was like, oh my God, what? I wasn't a commentator. I was offered to do something, and I looked at it as, well, it's my chance to try to stay within the sport, and I'm not going to be pissing people off. That didn't work long. So,
what do you think of the officiating these days?
I think a lot of the officiating is great. I think, you know, I've said this, you know, what's gotten me in a lot of trouble is I've said things, and what I've said is not wrong. I'm not going to change it. It's happening today. There are people that want to be associated with the sport of MMA because it's the new thing. And it's big, and it's getting bigger because of, like, the UFC. But, you know, it's funny, you know, everyone, you know, Dana's mad at me and all that. Dana and I look at things very much the same many times, is that Dana wants people to understand what's going on in the sport. So when you have a judge's decision, it's the right decision. Now, there's going to always be close fights, and there's always going to be fights where people look at and say, oh, I think fighter A won while fighter B actually got the decision. You can have those close ones, and you know what? There's minute differences, and you could have picked either guy. But there are people that are involved in officiating in MMA who have no idea what the fighters are truly doing. They don't understand, you know, if you're judging a fight, you should understand what type of takedown the fighter is using. Mm-hmm. Is he using a double leg? Is he using a lateral drop? Is that a Sienagi? Is that a Taito? What did he do? Who actually initiated what went on? Just because, you know, he's got a Taito and he's trying this, and this guy starts to block it, and he gets, you've got to know what they did to give credit to the right person. That's a problem. When you have judges that can't sit there and go, I know what that is. That's great. And understand the setups of what is happening on the ground. You're never going to get good officiating where people are making the right decisions all the time until they are educated enough to know what the fighters are doing.
Should the referee be another judge?
You know, I'm not saying that. I don't think the referee should. I think the referee's got enough, and it shouldn't be that he's trying to judge, because as a referee, I'll tell you, I don't watch the fight when I'm inside the same way I watch it if I'm outside. Right. I'm usually, you know, in a fight, things are usually happening, and one guy starts to, you know, accept more damage than another, and I tend to watch that guy a lot more than I'm watching what this guy is doing to him. I'm right. watching what's occurring to him. So I could, you know, actually miss things that he's doing back at times and not give him enough credit. So, I mean, I don't think it's the proper thing. I think there should be the three judges. I think the referee should do his job, and the judges should do their job. But, you know, there's a lot of things going on. There's positioning when it comes to referees. We got referees standing people up out of positions. I've got tapes. I go to shows and I'll watch. A fighter is getting just beat on his feet. He's getting beat down, and he can't take this guy down. Finally, he gets him down. Boom. And gets to a side control, we'll say, and he's just sitting there, and he's taking 2.5 minutes of getting his butt kicked. And so now he's in side control for 15 seconds, and referee goes, stop, stand up. And you look and you go, do you understand what you did? The fighter's not only fighting his opponent, he's fighting the referee too.
Right.
And it's not fair. It's unfortunate. You see a guy, you know, I've seen guys, they take a guy down, get to a mount position, you hear people in the crowd yelling, oh, stand him up, because they want to see that huge knockout. And the referee, after 30 seconds, stop, they stand him up. This guy gets up out of a dominant position, one that he can't be hurt in, that he can inflict a lot of damage on his opponent. He stands up, this guy stands up, kicks him in the head, he goes out. Why was he able to deliver the kick? Because we have a referee that doesn't understand what he's looking at and allows him to be pulled out of a dominant position when he should never do that.
Royce Gracie would say the officiating is too stringent these days. Do you think that the refs these days have too much leeway to do that?
I think Royce would like a more open format because that's what he came up with, right. and that's what he was good with. My one thing is I'd love to see, I don't care where you go, every fight takes place under the same rule set, because sometimes there's little variations and the fans don't know that there's variations within that promotion, within that state, and they think the referee is doing something wrong or the fighter should do something different when they can't.
Talk about the evolution of the mixed martial artists from, because you've seen them all. You've seen the street fighters, you've seen the wrestlers, you've seen the jiu-jitsu guys, and then you've got George St. Pierre and people like that who have
scary dude, isn't he?
Tremendous skills.
Yeah.
So what do you think the evolution is, and what do you think the next step is for UFC fighter?
When it started, it was, you know, jiu-jitsu against karate or boxing, and it was brought out that way, and that was the way most guys were. But now the guys that are good, they're good at everything. Now they're not going to be, you know, you look and say, well, is you know, George St. Pierre as good on his feet as Floyd Mayweather? Well, he can't be.
Right.
There's so many more elements for George St. Pierre to work and have to train at. The style of fighters today, they're incredible athletes, but you're gonna see the skills of the future are gonna far surpass even the George St. Pierre's of today. I mean, I got kids in my school that are, you know, 9 and 10 years old, and you watch the stuff they do and they look like a small adult. You know, just the combinations they throw with their hands or the submissions and the way that they transition on the ground, you look and you say, the future is going to be, these guys are going to be incredibly scary compared to what we were used to in the old dinosaur age.
More with Big John McCarthy. Stand by.
Coming up next on Fighting Words with Mike Straka.
Let's get it on. You became famous for that. Where'd that come from?
I tell people all the time, if there's one thing I could change, I think I would change it.
That's coming up next on Fighting Words with Mike Straka. Welcome back to Fighting Words with Mike Straka. This week's guest, Big John McCarthy.
Welcome back to Fighting Words, Big John McCarthy. You know, a lot of guys will say, a lot of fighters will say, I don't remember the wins, but I do remember the losses very well. What do you remember? What's memorable for you when you're reffing a fight?
when I'm reffing the fight, or
after, or, you know, what is a memorable fight?
What's memorable for a referee is when he makes big mistakes. You know, when you screw up, it sticks with you, and you think about it, and it's, you know, because you want to do what's right for the fighters, you want to do what's right for the fans, and if you make that mistake, you know, it eats you up.
What mistakes did you make where you...
Oh, I mean, I've made, you know, mistakes. The one thing is I didn't have anybody to learn from. And so really, you know, I was, you know, figuring things out from one show to the next. And I was, you know, figuring out what worked, what didn't work, how to do something to make it better for you. And I made huge mistakes. I have, you know, I did Sakuraba versus Conan Silvera in Japan, you know. I screwed up, and when I look at it, I look at it different than the fan would look at it. I screwed up because I was supposed to protect Sakuraba because he had no fights at that time. He had one fight, supposedly it was against Kimo Leopoldo, and it was a fake fight in Japan. It wasn't real. And so no one really knew, and I definitely didn't know how good a fighter Sakuraba was or was gonna end up being either. And it was bad for two reasons. Silvera was doing a pretty good job against him. He did hurt him with a punch, but when he went down, I went and I stopped the fight. And you could see when I looked at it on replay, you see he goes down, but he's trying to grab a hold of an ankle, so he was still there, and so I stopped it too soon. And you know, the real problem was is they're gonna put him back in, because I said, hey, I screwed that up. And they're gonna put him back in against Silver again for the finals, because Tank Abbott had fought and he hurt his hand and he couldn't fight. So it worked out well for them. But Silvera was the guy, you know, Conan was sitting there saying, realizing, hey, this guy's good, you know, and I got to fight him again, you know, and I really think it took mentally, it took him out of his game.
Right.
And so it wasn't so much, I hurt both fighters, and so that bothered me. You know, when Matt Lindland fought Murillo Bustamante for the UFC middleweight championship, mm-hmm. I screwed that up because Matt Lindland tapped, and I listened to him, he says, I didn't. And I was like, maybe I was wrong in what I saw, and I learned. You make a decision, be decisive, that's it.
Should there be some kind of class for refs?
There should be some certification, is what I believe. There has to be something for someone to have to go through to show their qualifications, to allow them to be in the middle between two human beings who could possibly do something that could cause them serious injury. You know, it's not something where you can sit there and say, you know, everyone's gonna be, this person's always gonna be perfect. No one is perfect. I'm not perfect, Herb's not perfect, Eve's not perfect, Steve's not perfect, Mario, any of the ones that people recognize, none of us are perfect. It's impossible. You're a human, you're gonna make mistakes. But you try to limit those mistakes. If you make them, I don't wanna make it again. I wanna learn why I made that mistake. How is it that I can do it so it won't happen again? And then go out and just do the best job you can do. I have a school right now. I have a class I teach, you know, and it's not easy to pass. I've had certain commissions tell me that it's too hard to pass. I look at it, not everyone's meant to be a Navy SEAL. Now, I'm not saying referees are Navy SEALs, but there's a lot of people that try out to be a Navy SEAL that are good athletes, that are good at what they do, and they don't make it for certain reasons. Well, it's the same thing with refereeing. You know what? It's not for everybody.
Does it ever go through your mind when you're in the cage that somebody's life depends on your decision? There could be a time when somebody's life depends on your decision to stop.
Absolutely.
Fighting. How much pressure is that?
It's huge. The thing with fighting and with people, and this is what I tell all referees, is when you go to a fight and you sit there, you buy your seat, you know, a fan buys their ticket, and you know, they paid their hard-earned money to, you know, have that, to go watch, to be entertained. They have certain expectations. But what they don't have is a responsibility that's associated with it. So if they go to the show and one of the fighters in the show gets seriously hurt, the referee doesn't stop the fight, we'll say, when maybe they should, and the guy takes too many blows and is unable to recover from what has occurred and come back and be normal and is permanently altered in his life, or his life is taken by that, you know, decision not to do something. The fan who's on the outside, they can, I didn't do it. And they can walk away from it and say, oh, I saw it, he should have stopped it. But they don't have any responsibility associated with it. The referee, when he's in there, he is responsible for the safety of the fighters. And, you know, a long time ago, I came up with, and it was at UFC 3, you know, I said, you know, I need to be able to stop the fight. If the fighter cannot intelligently defend themselves, I've got to be able to stop the fight. And it might be that they can't intelligently defend themselves for just for a second. Eyes go back, their brain housing group is not functioning in a normal way. Is it the next shot, if I let it go through, is that going to be the one that's going to permanently injure this person? It may not, but it may. And I want to be able to get in there and stop it, so at least I know I did the right thing. The referee has got to live with whatever they do.
What fighters up and coming that you see these days, you say, okay, that guy is going to be the next champion?
Next champion? Wow. I mean, there's so many guys out there that are so, I get to do shows all over the place now, and I really enjoy it. I have a blast doing it. And there's so many good guys. If you're going to look at the top levels and stuff, you can look at some guys that are in the UFC, and you can see, you know, he's going to be good. You know, in the strike forces and stuff, you know, I look at a Gegard Mousasi, man, he's going to be incredible. He's already incredible.
Yep.
But he's only going to get better.
And he also retired by the time he's 30.
Yeah, well, they all say that. You know, a Cain Velasquez, you know, I'm watching him, and he keeps getting better and better. And there's guys that, you know, I watch, and it's like, I thought, you know, they might be, and they've retooled themselves. And Frank Mir, you know, for a while there, Frank was done. He was. And you look at him now, he's doing a great job, even though he says bad things about Brock Lesnar, which is, you know, another subject. But you watch him fight now, he's so much better now than what he was. He has made himself due to training the right way, training with the right people, putting his ego to the side as far as training matters and learning from other people and things. There's guys that have been with the sport for a while, but now they're at a different level within the sport and what they're doing. And, you know, a guy like a Brock Lesnar, he's just going to get better and better as long as he's open to learning, which he is always seems to be. You know, the sport's going to evolve, but there's guys that are, you know, are in there now that haven't been around that long that I think they're going to be incredible. And there are guys that have been around for a while that they just keep getting better, you know.
Let's get it on. You became famous for that. Where'd that come from?
I tell people all the time, if there's one thing I could change, I think I would change it. And I say it because, you know, no one comes and pays their hard-earned money to watch the referee. At the beginning, Art Davey was at UFC 2. He pulls me in, he says, hey, I need to talk to you. And I said, yeah, what is it? And he says, yeah, I want you to start, you know, the fights with, you know, a saying and a hand signal. I said, okay, what do you want? Well, I don't know, that's up to you. And I was like, Art, I got no clue. And he goes, well, you got to think of something. I said, I got two guys, one standing on this side of the cage that want to come in and kill each other. I said, what do you want me to say? He goes, well, I don't know. You got to come on. I said, I'm going to ask this guy, are you ready? Well, let's get it on. He goes, that's perfect. That's what I want. Okay. And that's how it started. You know, the biggest problem is, it's not about the referees. And you see some guys, you know, the thing I don't like is you'll see some guys coming, you know, come to the middle of the thing and you've got, you know, the announcer comes with a microphone and all of a sudden he says, all right, gentlemen, we're here tonight in remembrance of Fairtex University, wherever, and they start going on these rambling diatribes. It's like, dude, no one's there to listen to you. You know, shut up and start the fight. If you want to say something about, hey, you know what, protect yourself at all times, that's all normal. So we went over the rule, okay. But don't start sitting there saying, you know, let's show what female MMA is all about. They all know what it's about. They've already bought their tickets and they're sitting there or they're watching on TV. It's not about you. And so the big thing I try to get new guys, I say, hey, whatever you're going to say, you know what, start the fight, start it clean. Don't make it about you so much. And so the one thing with Let's Get It On, yeah, I do it all the time now because it's what people expect. But I try to make it to where it ain't about me. It's about the two fighters.
All right, Big John McCarthy, thank you so much for doing a show.
My pleasure, sir. Thank you very much, Mike.
The This has been an exclusive presentation of HDNet.